Okay, so with this in hand, how do we write out the shape function, the basis functions, right? So again, let me now draw this, and again, because I'm going to draw the basis functions here, I'm going to draw this triangle, though it is, of course, the same triangle I had in the previous slide. I'm drawing it now in perspective view. Okay. All right. So in this view, okay, I'm going to first write out the basis functions and then sketch them out. Remember, this is A equals 1. That is A equals 2. And this is A equals 3. Okay, so in that setting, it's really easy. N1 is the function of C1, C2. C3 is C1, N2 is C2, N3 is C3. Okay, and in particular, it is the convenience of writing out these basis functions in this manner, in this, so to speak, completely symmetric manner, that also motivates the definition of the third of these coordinates, C3, even though the span of the space is just 2, right? Consider this, the rank of this, the dimensionality of the space, sorry, is just 2, okay? Right? So let's sketch these, right? So I'll sketch one of them to begin with, and so I'm going to sketch N1, okay? As you can see from that, N1 goes to 1, right? At C1 equals 1, right? At C1 equals 0, which is the C2 axis, it drops to 0, right? So it is 0 all along the C2 axis, right? And it goes down linearly. Okay, along the line, right? Along this line here, right? Along that line, right? The N1, of course, is always equal to C1. Right? Along that line, it slopes down linearly from 1 to 0. Okay, that is C1, and likewise we can construct C2 and C3. C2 is 1 there, slopes down linearly to 0 at the other two nodes. Right? That goes down to 0, right? And likewise C3. Or N3, sorry, is 1 at that node, goes down to 0 linearly. Okay? So that is N3. We should write, okay, N2 is that basis function, and N1 we've already, sorry, N1 I wrote in green, N1 I drew in green. Okay, So those are our basis functions, and one thing to note, of course, is that you will have observed that I refer to these basis functions as being linear rather than bilinear. Okay, and it should be completely clear why, right? They are indeed just linear, not bilinear. Okay, so that's it. Once we have these basis functions, everything proceeds just as before. We just need to pay attention to the fact that the number of nodes in our element is not 4. Okay, even for the simplest of these, of this class of elements, it's not 4, it's 3. And we can go ahead and construct our entire finite element formulation. One can go on to higher order triangular elements also. There are quadratic triangular elements which involve mid-side nodes as well, and it's an one can define the basis functions for them also as an extension of what we've done here. I'm not going to get into it because really if you do need quadratic triangles, you are probably better off just using quadrilaterals, bilinear quadrilaterals anyway. Okay, so these elements have certain advantages. The primary advantage of them is of course simplicity. Okay, so simplex elements in general. They're simpler than quadrilaterals and hexahedra. Right? Of course, I haven't put down the simplex element in 3D, but I'll do that pretty soon. They're simpler, but there is a drawback, right? There's an obvious drawback. And what do you think that could be? Just the basis, right? I mean, you're using a lower order basis. You start out with a linear basis instead of a bilinear basis, so your representation of functions is already a little poorer. They also are, there are issues of incompleteness of polynomials and so on, which arise. So in general, they don't work as well as the corresponding bilinear, biquadratic elements and so on. Okay, but nevertheless, they're simple to use and they are convenient. They also, of course, for certain problems of generating meshes, they do present an easier task. Okay, but that has largely been overcome in the finite element community. All right, so we have this, right? Let me just put down the simplex element in 3D, and then we'll have got this covered as well. Okay, so in 3D. Right, so we have tetrahedra. Okay, so a general element in the physical domain may look like that. Right, it'll have 4 nodes, right, the simplest linear tetrahedron. Right, I'm showing you the simplest linear tetrahedron. So this would be our omega e. And it would be constructed, as you may imagine, from a parent domain, right, which is also in 3D. But it is a tetrahedron in 3D, right? The sort of a right tetrahedron in 3D. So it is okay, and oops. Okay, I guess in order to make it completely clear, I should make some of these lines dashed. Yep, that's really the only line I needed to make dashed, okay? So, So the coordinate directions would be x1, x2. Now we would properly have a x3 coordinate dimension, right? Our nodes, and here in the physical domain, we may have numbered them as whatever, a equals 1, 2, maybe 3, and 4, right? What happens here is that we have four nodes, of course. Right? So we will label them here as A equals 1, A equals 2, A equals 3, and here we will get A equals 4. Okay? For convenience, again, we will define now C4 equals 1 minus C1 minus C2 minus C3. Okay? Right? Using the same sort of idea. In that case, we use this idea of area coordinates. Now we can, I guess, effectively call them volume coordinates, right? But the idea is the same. Now all we have is N1, function of C1, C2, C3, and C4. Right, is just C1, right, until we come down to N4, and that's it, right? We just go ahead, we construct, we now know that the simplest of our basis functions is linear. There are four nodes to the element, 4 degrees of freedom. We just go ahead and construct our entire finite element formulation just as before. Okay, calculation of derivatives and everything is straightforward. One remark I could make is that now when we work with linears, linear triangles and or linear simplex elements, lead to what is the order of any gradient now of our basis functions, and therefore and the order of our representation of any gradient field. It's constant, right? Right, so if we take any of these linear basis functions and compute its derivative with respect to any physical coordinate, right, what we will see is that it leads to constant gradients. All right, and this in some cases can be an advantage for simplicity of calculation, but of course, if your best representation of gradients within the element is a constant, you are obviously losing some fidelity of representation of functions and so forth. Okay, you're just not able to represent higher order functions, right? So there are those sorts of drawbacks as well. There is also when it comes to integrating up with these types of simplex elements, of course there are special numerical quadrature rules, numerical integration rules, just as we did in the case of triangles. We can also define higher order tetrahedra, okay, just as we do for triangles, right? And one can construct the triquadratic, quadratic tetrahedra, or cubic tetrahedra, and so on. One can also define that there are numerical quadrature or numerical integration rules defined for them. The optimal, the optimality of Gaussian quadrature, however, does not hold for triangular elements, right? There are other numerical integration rules that are used. So Gauss quadrature, Gaussian quadrature is no longer optimal. Nevertheless, these can be defined, these have been defined, and they're actually available in much of the finite element literature. Okay, but we can stop this segment here, and indeed this unit. Hopefully it's allowed us a unified representation of basis functions, of definitely of the linears, bilinears, and trilinear, and therefore, you know, quadratics, biquadratics, and triquadratics, and so on, based on Lagrange polynomial functions. And we've also seen how simplex elements are defined, the simplest versions of simplex elements, the linears. We also saw in the course of this unit the extension of quadrature to three dimensions, for two and three dimensions for basis functions that are constructed from Lagrange polynomials. All right, we'll end the segment here. When we return, we'll start up a new unit.